In Tel Aviv, Israelis join the families of hostages still held by Hamas in Gaza on the eve of the October 7 attack anniversary. Hamas took about 250 hostages during their assault on southern Israel last year. Israel says about 97 have yet to return home. U.S. and Israeli officials fear most of them have already been killed in captivity.
It doesn't feel like 1 year. It feels like one whole day. It's devastating to think that they're still there, and we can't see any light at the end of the tunnel.
You don't do whatever you can to get the hostages back. You're a partner in this crime, and we have to do whatever we can to get the hostages back.
In Paris, hundreds of protesters marched near the Eiffel Tower calling for the release of the remaining hostages held by Hamas. The march followed a commemoration of the October 7 attack by the Jewish community, where French Jews denounced what they called the worsening climate insecurity in France. But protests have also been held around the world in support of the Palestinian people. Demonstrations were held in major cities from Jakarta to Istanbul and followed protests on Saturday in major European capitals, as well as Washington and New York. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu meets with the Army's North Command chiefs to discuss operations against Hezbollah in Lebanon. Netanyahu's visit comes on the eve of the anniversary of the October 7 attack on southern Israel, which triggered the Gaza War. This was followed by cross-border strikes by Hezbollah in solidarity with Hamas. Netanyahu tells troops Israel was changing reality.
A year ago, we suffered a terrible blow. For the past 12 months, we've been changing reality from end to end. The whole world is astounded at the blows you inflict on our enemies. And I salute you and tell you, you are the generation of victory. Together, we will fight and together we will win, with God's help.
The initial Hamas attack killed about 1,200 people. Israel's subsequent military assault on Gaza has killed nearly 42,000 Palestinians. Israel launches its most intense bombardment of Beirut since it escalated its campaign against Hezbollah last month. Late Sunday night, large explosions were seen in the city's southern suburbs. The Israeli military issued new evacuation orders for residents in advance of further strikes. Meanwhile, Lebanon's ambassador to the UK says Israel's killing of Hezbollah leader Hassan Saeed Nasrallah late last month derailed a potential ceasefire.
We're dealing with the warmongering Israeli government, and I think when they tell you that their concerns is about rockets being fired, when they tell you that their concerns is about 60,000 civilians that were displaced from northern Israel, there is a diplomatic way to address these concerns. Well, they chose a different path. They chose a path of violence, of brutalizing a whole population.
Florida prepares for its largest evacuation since 2017 as Hurricane Milton continues to intensify in the Gulf of Mexico. On its path to the U.S. southern coast, Milton, which strengthened from a tropical storm to a hurricane on Sunday, is projected to make landfall Wednesday morning, most likely hitting near the heavily populated Tampa Bay area. The new hurricane has the potential to affect areas already hit hard by Helene, which made landfall further north on September 26. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis warns of a potentially higher storm surge and more power outages, and says destruction from Helene could be compounded. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region.
We begin in Buncombe County, North Carolina, where rescue crews continue to work around the clock in search of more than 200 people who remain missing in the aftermath of Hurricane Helene. The death toll in what's considered the deadliest hurricane to make landfall in the U.S. mainland since Katrina in 2005 has now surpassed 200 on Thursday, and officials say that figure could rise. More than 70 people died in Buncombe County alone. Asheville Mayor Esther Mannheimer described the impact of the hurricane as unbelievable.
You can't adequately describe it in words. It's we've never seen anything like this here in Asheville. It's unprecedented.
Helene's unprecedented storm surge left many communities underwater, without power or drinkable water. Government crews have been getting help from citizen-led volunteer groups to deliver aid to stranded communities on foot and by helicopter and mule trains. Meanwhile, Guam, a U.S. island territory located in the Northwest Pacific Ocean, lies on the path of typhoons. In times of calamity, when oftentimes power lines are the first to get struck, Guamanian officials are working to make the island 100% reliant on renewable energy by 2045. In August, a group of Guam energy stakeholders and government leaders gathered to discuss ways to transition Guam to 100% renewable energy in the next two decades. Power Solutions CEO Filipino Rino Manzano talks about his own company's initiatives to build a sustainable future for Guam.
The key really for us is, would it be something that could still be used 10 or 20 years from now? So we rely on new technologies. We work with our technology partners, trying to identify, hey, what would work really for the community that we would like to do renewable projects. It's not just one product. You have to really do a holistic approach, looking at identifying, okay, these are inverters, there's a lot of components in there, so you need to make sure that everything are compatible in there. And at the end of the day, it's something that should work, and it shouldn't be something that's too expensive.
Guam officials are also pushing for renewable energy to lower utility bills for consumers. Guam, which is mainly powered by expensive imported fuel oil, also hosts several energy-intensive U.S. military bases. And finally, just in time for the celebration of Philippine-American History Month this October, one of the finest U.S. institutions, Yale University, is offering Tagalog classes for the very first time, and it's set to start in the fall of 2025. The Council on Southeast Asia Studies at Yale University has officially advertised for a Filipino instructor position to be filled. The creation of a Tagalog program came after members of a Filipino student organization called CASAMA expressed their frustrations over the lack of such course. More than 380 students and faculty members signed CASAMA's petition to include Tagalog in Yale's international language courses, and their persistence paid off.
I believe that it is a recognition that Filipinos are being seen and heard in this country, and that the student population is now becoming aware of the need to be able to communicate with us in our own language.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website and YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at The Rundown.
Let's get an update on the weather now from Pagasa forecaster Veronica Torres. Good morning, Veronica.
Good morning to you and to all of our audience at ANC. As of 3 a.m. today, the low pressure area that we're monitoring was at 165 kilometers west-northwest of Coron, Palawan. It is embedded along the Intertropical Convergence Zone, or ITCZ, which is affecting southern Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. And because of this low pressure area and ITCZ, we're expecting cloudy skies with scattered rains and thunderstorms over Bicol region, Mimaropa, Quezon, Rizal, Laguna, and Batangas. For Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we're expecting partly cloudy to cloudy skies with chances of localized thunderstorms. We don't have any gale warning raised over any parts of the country. Also, we're monitoring another tropical cyclone outside the Philippine area of responsibility. As of 3 a.m. today, it's at 2,340 kilometers east of extreme northern Luzon. It's unlikely, or it has a low chance, to enter the Philippine area of responsibility. And for the low pressure inside the PAR, it's unlikely to develop into a tropical cyclone. And that's the latest from Pagasa Weather Forecasting Center. Veronica C. Torres reporting.
Thank you very much for the update, Veronica. Former President Rodrigo Duterte gunning for a return to politics. He says he plans to run for mayor of Davao City again, citing public clamor. He also hints on possibly running in tandem with his son, incumbent Davao City Mayor Sebastian Duterte.
thing that I'm running? You are speculating that I am running. Is that the popular notion, sir?
Yes. Yes, Mr. President.
Yan ang isip niyo. And it is the almost a... O sige, tatakbo na lang ako. Eh, yung gusto ninyo. I've been your mayor for so many years now. You think that I can carry a national campaign at my age? Magkukulapse lang ako niyan eh. Well, anyway guys, I think that at my age, 73, mukhang hindi ko na kaya. Let us be realistic about it. Gusto ng tao, ibig sabihin?
Yes.
Sige, mag-mayor tayo.
Duterte adds they have yet to speak as a family on their political plans amid talks of a Duterte seeking a Senate seat. He also claims he is ready to retire from politics. Former President Duterte ready to face the House Quad Committee investigation into the alleged links between illegal drugs and pogos. He admits extrajudicial killings were committed in his bloody drug war, but he was firm he is not involved in pogos.
Anong gusto nang malaman sa akin?
They're investigating the extradition.
Ako, totoo yan.
Relations sa Pogo at
that. Wala ako. Wala tayong Pogo. Kaya nga naman matay yung mga tao dito dahil yan sa illegal drugs. Pogo, that is, we are too far away from that. Hindi mo ka alam maglaro ng Pogo.
So you're going to appear, Mayor?
Sa?
Sa Congress.
Well, if they will invite me. I just hope that they would ask educated questions.
Meanwhile, the former president stressed the importance of having an opposition in a democratic country. Duterte said, the opposition is essential for check and balance, but not to the point of destroying the president.
Alam ni President siya, wala kaming away. But for the sake na sabihin mo, kailangan may opposition, then I would gladly take the role as an opposition. Not to destroy the president, but to be there just to see to it that everything is followed and everything is done correctly. Hindi yung targeted kay Presidente. Kaibigan kami.
Duterte, while president, took a hard line against critics and members of the political opposition, including former Senator Leila de Lima, who was detained for drug cases that she has been since acquitted from. His administration also oversaw a crackdown on activists, many of whom were accused without evidence of links to communist rebels. The Philippine poll body expects more aspirants to formalize their bids in the final 2 days of COC filing. So far, the COMELEC has received 78 COCs for senatorial aspirants and 87 for party lists. On day six, Congressman Erwin Tulfo filed his COC for senator after his brother Ben Tulfo did the same, potentially joining their other brother, Rafi, in the 24-seat Senate. If they win, Erwin believes it wouldn't translate to a political dynasty.
As long as there's no law yet, then we let the people decide. Di po ba? Kung ngayon kung may batas na ho, then we stop. Hindi po titigil yan hanggang wala pong batas.
Meanwhile, Senator Coco Pimentel has set his sights on Marikina City's 1st District seat, running against former ally incumbent Mayor Marcy Teodoro.
Baka natakot siya dun sa District 2. So tayo naman, eh, hindi tayo dinaga. So tayo, itutuloy natin yung plano natin sa District 1.
Do not make promises na wala kang intention to pa rin.
Also notable on day 6, former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo formalized her candidacy for Pampanga's 2nd District Representative.